Thank you. So I thank you, the organizer, for this conference, this invitation to speak here. So I will speak with you of some physical subject, a priori, some mathematics connected with the theory of particles, of fundamental particles. So I must say small word about that at the beginning. So the fundamental particles of matter are entirely composed of spin 1/2 particles, fermions, and they consist of quark and of lepton. So lepton are the electrons, the neutrino, and things like that, and they are these strange particles, the quark, which have 3 degrees of freedom more, which you cannot distinguish because there is an SU3 invariant which permutes them, which are called the degree of freedom. So this means that they are described by a quantum field or classical field, it depends if you want, on Minkowski space, we have spin 1/2 with value in C3, so a three-dimensional space. Okay, and there is something which has no explanation, but on which I will give a description, which is the fact that for each lepton, for instance the electron, there is an associated quark, and vice versa. For each quark, there is an associated lepton. So this is called the lepton-quark symmetry or quark-lepton symmetry. And at the very beginning of my talk, I will give a description of this in a very specific term. So let me start. So, comment on marche, c'est ça? Comment on avance? Et on avance de ce côté, là, comme ça. OK, so, non, yes. At the very beginning, you see, I asked me a very strange question, a little crazy. Why SU3? OK, because of course you can say, well, the internal space of the quark is a three-dimensional complex space, isomorphic to C3, OK? But so you can accept that it is a Hilbert space. But then the natural group would be U3, not SU3. So what is the profound meaning of the fact that we need this unimodularity condition? And is there an interpretation of this? So you see, the unimodularity condition means simply that there is a volume, which is a complex volume, which is preserved, OK? So this complex volume is a triform, which you can normalize in such a way that the norm of this triform is 1, okay, by a scaling. And it's of course, and with that, of course, you can define an antisymmetric. So you see, you have to make a distinction between the dimension 3 and the dimension 2. Because if it would be SU2, I would say, okay, but SU2 is a U1 quaternionic, so it means that I have Hilbert, a one-dimensional quaternionic space. But here is not the same, okay? So here there is something more. But now, with a scalar product and a three-form, you can construct an internal product by the following formula, okay? Which is here. So of course, so this defines an internal product inside this, and of course we have the scalar product, and SU3 is exactly the group which preserves both, okay? So when you see that, you have naturally, it's natural to try to unify these two products, one which is internal and the other which is in the ground field, okay, just by adding a unit to your original three-dimensional space, three-dimensional algebra, with this cross product, which is defined by this formula. Okay?
Excuse me.
But of course, before that, sorry, but...
Your scalar for that is curvilinear.
Of course, it's a Hilbert space, yes.
But the volume form is
yes,
linear.
Yes, okay, no problem. This means that the product is antisymmetric and antilinear.
Okay,
I could have defined, at the beginning I defined it like that with a bar over the Z1 in order that everything is complex linear. But in any case, since I have a scalar product which is sesquilinear, I will need some complex transformation. So finally, I choose a form which will be close to something on which we shall arrive quickly. So before doing that, okay, we have to look what is the norm of the product of two elements, okay? And you see, when you see this formula over there, okay, you see that, of course, if the two Z are orthogonal, this means that the product is really, the norm of the product is the product of the norm. So it's very natural to add a unit, okay, in such a way that the product of the norm of the product is the product of the norm in the whole thing, okay? So I will add a unit, okay, so, okay, and now I have, I am on C4, but of course, here I take 0 and C3, my original space, and this is the original product. But now I can say, okay, this is the projection on the unit of this product, this new product, and this is the internal product at the... I can normalize these two things as I want, okay? And in order that I have this relation, I only need that the norm of alpha and the norm of beta is 1, okay? For some crazy reason, I will choose beta equal I, okay? Okay, now if I require that I have this formula, okay, there is a solution, but of course it's not unique. Since you see, I can choose alpha and beta as I want, I could have chosen my product bilinear in order to be anti-linear. But, okay, so this product satisfies this, okay, all what I want. And now what you observe is that there is an involution on this product which consists to associate to Z, big Z, small Z, big minus big Z and small Z bar, okay, which is such that if I take the conjugate multiplied by the element, it's the same thing in the other order, and it's a square of the norm times 1, okay? So this implies that your algebra is a division algebra in an obvious way. Now you see, in the product, a lot of complex conjugation arrive. So this product is in fact a real product, underlying product is a real product in a space of dimension 8, okay? So there are not so much norm division algebra, okay? This is necessarily isomorphic to the octonion algebra. And whenever I make other choice, I will all find on another form, other basis for the octonion algebra. So what is the result of this story? Is that SU3 is the automorphism of this octonion algebra, but the automorphism which preserves the splitting C plus C3 of the octonion, okay? So a choice of the one imaginary octonionic which will play the role of the I, okay? And now you see, I start from E on which SU3 acts as the space of quark. Now I have I the factor C, okay? So, of course, the factor C does not, since it's the component of the unit, it does not see at all this SU3, because SU3 preserves the product, so the unit. So you see, there is this part which corresponds to the quark, and the part which corresponds to a complex, okay? And it's very natural to associate this complex to the lepton associated to the quark, since I know that each quark has a lepton and vice versa, okay? And this is the key of the beginning of this, the crazy key of the beginning of this story, okay? Now, when I saw that, I was very unhappy for several reasons. The first reason is that first I was not very fond of non-associative algebra, and the second reason is that even if this is non-associative, it would be nice, but if it would be the observable of a quantum system, and this is not the case. So at that time, I remember that in fact, in the classification of particles, there are three, when discovered that there are not only one generation of lepton quark, mais with, for instance, the electron and the neutrino, but there are two others. There are three generations which were discovered later, okay? But now it's well established, okay? With their quark and everything. And thinking to the octonion and this sort of underlying triviality which is observed, of course, I was directly led to consider the exceptional Jordan algebra of 3x3 Hermitian octonionic matrix. And there, of course, this is a perfect quantum system. This is a perfect quantum system, perfect observable algebra for what I will call a quantum space. Okay, a quantum space does not exist, but it's a very convenient picture to consider that the algebra that I have are the analog of real function on this fictive object, okay? So when I speak of the exceptional quantum space, I mean that the algebra which is behind is this exceptional algebra. So before that, I have to explain you what I mean by finite dimensional quantum space, okay? So, essentially, a finite dimensional observable algebra. So, first of all, you must know, I think that this is really true, that quantum mechanics is nothing else than real spectral theory. In all the forms, there are all the subtlety, but in finite dimension, there are not much subtlety. So, in finite dimension, I can say, explain what is the most general situation where you have spectral theory, okay? Real spectral theory. So this is what I will, try to do. So here, here is the table of the fundamental particles which constitute the particle of matter. There are some other particles, but these are particles which carry the interaction. I will speak of them later. But for the moment, I look just at matter. This composes every atom, every kernel of atom, everything, okay? So you see, one family, for instance, the first family, which was known from a lot of time, correspond to the electron and its neutrino, and the corresponding quark. And there are these two other families which were discovered later. So this is the experimental situation. Okay, so now let me see. If you want to have a quantum geometry, you start with a real vector space, okay, which you want that it is the space of your observable algebra, and you want that to have spectral theory for each element there. Spectral theory means what? It means that you can take function, real function of this element for sufficiently many real functions, but in finite dimensional space, polynomial functions are sufficient, of course, okay? So you have to be able to define polynomial function of any element, and that this is another element of this vector space. So this means in particular that you have a square, hein, the polynomial x2. a square which you expect is quadratic. Quadratic means that you can extract a symmetric bilinear product from this formula by depolarization, I would say. Okay? So for the moment, nothing. Okay? Now, once I have the square, I can define by induction the power n by taking, okay, x to the power n plus 1 is x times xn. So for the moment, there is nothing. But if I want that I have a good representation of the polynomial algebra, of course, I need that what is called the power associativity. And this is sufficient, in fact. So I will assume that I have this power associativity, okay? Now, to have a good spectral theory, of course, real spectral theory, you need that if you have a sum of squares, which is zero, then each element is zero, okay? So this is called formal real condition, okay? And now it's a theorem by Jordan, I think, the first one, which a finite dimensional commutative real algebra, which is power associative and formally real, is a Jordan algebra. That is, it satisfies the Jordan identity, which is this identity. An algebra which satisfies this identity, which is of order 3 in the product, okay, is a Jordan algebra. And this Jordan algebra, which satisfy the formally real condition, are called Euclidean Jordan algebra, or formally real Jordan algebra, but I prefer Euclidean Jordan algebra. So now any Jordan algebra is power associative. So the first condition is automatically satisfied, but this one, no. Okay? So these are the class of algebra which are observable algebra for a finite dimension. Okay? So I would say for finite quantum, to describe finite quantum space. Okay? Okay. So now I will describe this condition. So, okay, this is necessary as I explain. Okay. So, in most cases, of course, this algebra appears as a subalgebra of associative algebra stable by the anticommutator, that one half the commutator. In this case, of course, this Jordan algebra are called special. Okay? In this case, I can use, of course, non-commutative geometry, which means associative geometry. Okay? And this is why, at the beginning, a lot of time ago, I introduced some matrix algebra, but a star algebra, knowing, of course, that it is a self-adjoint part which corresponds to the quantum observable. But once you have this algebra, which is called exceptional, of 3x3 octonionic matrix, you cannot do this anymore, okay? This is because this algebra, okay, I will come back on this, this is because this algebra cannot be described like that. It is not, this is a theorem of Albert, but in fact, when they discover that, Jordan, von Neumann, and Wigner ask to Albert, which was a mathematician there, they could not succeed to find them as a party stable in an associative algebra for the anticommutator. So they asked to Albert, and Albert proved that it is not possible. So it is exceptional, and in fact, in the list which will appear, it's the only one. But as soon as you have this one somewhere, you are squeezed. You cannot just content you with non-commutative geometry, you have something else to do. So now let me give the property of this finite dimensional Jordan algebra. So first, you have the spectral theory, okay? Okay? Where these are projectors in your algebra and give a resolution of the identity. And the number of projectors here is bounded by something which does not depend on the element of your algebra, but it depends only on the algebra itself, okay? So it's a finite number. So from this, of course, you have the functional calculus with the polynomial. And furthermore, any such algebra has a unit, okay? And any such algebra is a direct sum of a finite number of simple ideal. So to classify that algebra, you have only to classify the simple algebra of that kind, okay? So this was done by Jordan, von Neumann and Wigner. It appeared in a paper in 1934, sorry. But of course this paper was written much before, because it could not have been written with Jordan, von Neumann and Wigner in 34, because this was the Nazi period and it was not. Okay, so the classification is the following. You have a number which is a C, which is called by the mathematician the capacity, which was called the degree in the original paper of Jordan, von Neumann and Wigner, and which measure essentially the number, the maximal number of eigenvalue that you can have. So the maximal length of resolution of identity with primitive with projector, so which will be necessary primitive projector over there. So for C equal 1, it's R. So R, of course, with R, you can construct the function over a finite space. And I refer to this as the classical situation, okay? So for C equal 2, you have all the what is called the spin factor. So you see the spin factor, you have a unit, of course, and you have, say, Rn plus 1, and the element of Rn plus 1 satisfies this relation, okay? So you recognize, if you think of this as one half of the anticommutator, that this is exactly what characterizes the generator of a Clifford algebra. And in fact, there is an enveloping algebra, which is a Clifford algebra, so this algebra are all special, okay? Then, for C equal 3, so you have the 3 by 3 symmetric matrix, you have the 3 by 3 Hermitian complex matrix, the 3 by 3 octonionic complex matrix, and the famous algebra of 3 by 3 Hermitian octonionic matrix, okay? After, for n bigger or equal to 4, you have only the symmetric matrix over the real, the Hermitian matrix over the complex, the Hermitian matrix over the quaternion, and the Hermitian matrix of this order over the octonion are no more Jordan algebra. So there are no more observable algebra. So it stops here. So you can say, okay, and where are the 2 by 2 matrix? Of course they are here. And they correspond, the 2 by 2 matrix correspond to the case n plus 1 equal 9. Okay? This, well, but we shall come back to this later. Okay? So, now, this one, okay, as I announced, is exceptional. Okay. So, let me just remind you the notion for an arbitrary non-associative algebra. Well, the notion of center. So the center are the elements which commute with everybody. So here you are in commutative algebra, so it's nothing, but which associate to everywhere, to everybody. So which satisfies this condition where this triple bracket means the associator. Okay? So, bon, okay, there is this easy theorem, this is the dilemma. So, the point now, we need the derivation. So the derivation, morally, are the infinitesimal automorphism, okay? So it is very important. This is the analog of the vector field when you look at the function over a smooth manifold, okay? So, the derivation, first, is a module over the center. It's very easy to see that, okay? Second, they send the center into itself, and third, for the commutator of the operator, it's closed and it is a Lie algebra. So it is a Lie algebra and a module over the center, and there is a compatibility between both. which is a standard thing, and this object is called Lie-Reinhart algebra, I think. Okay. So this is, well, this is quite standard, okay? So now I have to introduce what is the analog. You see, when you are in space-time, you see, for particle, I say, there is an external space, an external algebra, and an internal algebra. The external algebra are the function over Minkowski space. So this means this function, but you have a metric. So the automorphism are not all the diffeomorphism of the space-time R4, but they are only the automorphism which preserves the metric, the Lorentzian metric, okay? And this is called the Poincaré group, okay? Which has the translation and the Lorentz transformation and the rotation, okay? So for the internal space, I have to, but obviously the representation of when you want to find the representation of different spin of the Poincaré group, you have to introduce some bundle over space-time. And the element of this representation are function with value in this bundle. Okay? This function with value in the bundle are module over all the function. So what we have to do now on the internal space, okay, which are this quantum observable algebra, is to look what is the analog of this module, okay? What is this, what are the module over a Jordan algebra, okay? With notion which we will use, of course. So for that, okay, you say, bon, you take a vector space, you have a Jordan algebra, not necessary, this is quite general, okay? And you look at a vector space on which you are right and left action of G, okay? Then you can look at the following algebra. You take the sum, which is the sum of G plus M, okay? The product is defined by this formula. It's called the null split extension because, of course, the product of two things like that is zero. You see, you have not two times a bilinear product in phi and phi prime, but only that, okay? And the condition for that to be a Jordan module is that this is again a Jordan algebra, okay? For this product. So if you spell this condition, they read like that. So the first one, of course, which is the commutativity of Jordan algebra, means that left and right multiplication are the same. So instead of speaking of Jordan bimodule, one usually speak of Jordan module. Like for Lie algebra, one speak of module or representation. Of course, for Lie algebra, there would be a minus here. Okay? So you forget this thing. And the important relation are these two relations. Okay? Now, if your Jordan algebra has a unit, you will say that M is unital if, of course, this unique imply multiplication by the unit is the same as the identity of the original module, okay? So there is a nicer way to see this relation, okay, which consists to introduce the multiplication, okay, left multiplication, but it's the same as the right, by this formula. Then the first relation reads simply like that, Lx, Lx squared, commute, okay? And the second relation, which looks complicated, is this relation here, okay? But you can split this relation in two. This is not, I don't want to prove this directly. The first, you take y and egal x, and then you find this relation here, okay? And then the rest to recover that is simply that if you take the double commutator of Lx, Ly, Lz, this is equal to L of commutator of Lx, Ly applied to Z, okay? And this is the same thing as the associator of minus the associator of X, Z, Y, okay? So what does this say? This says that the commutator Lx, Ly is a derivation of your Jordan algebra, okay? These derivations are called inner derivations. in all the simple Jordan algebra that I of the list before, all the derivations are inner. So you are sure that you don't miss derivation when you take this thing. Okay? Now, there is something which I think should have a generalization, but I had not the time to look at it, which is the notion, if you look at the free Jordan module and the free module over their center. Of course, if you have a free Jordan module, the restriction to the center gives you a free ZG module. But ZG is an associative commutative algebra. It's a standard algebra. So the module over that kind of thing is a theory which is very well known. In now, the point is that you can, if you restrict this, you can restrict if you have an homomorphism of free Jordan module from J tensor E to J tensor F, yes, of course, J is canonically a J module which is unital, whether. Okay, so free Jordan module is simply J tensorized with some vector space, we don't see anything, okay? So, and now such an homomorphism sends the part which is ZG tensor E onto the part which is ZG tensor F. Okay? This is the first thing. I don't want to spell the proof, okay? But the consequence of this is that if you look at the restriction from J tensor E to J Z tensor E, okay, this gives you an isomorphism category from the category of free Jordan module into the category of free ZG module. Okay? So this means that you don't for if you have an homomorphism of this free ZG module, you can lift it and recover the homomorphism of Jordan module, which look as a more complicated thing. So this is something very convenient, and I expect that this theorem has a generalization. Okay. So now there is a particular, again a particularity of the exceptional algebra, okay, which are that the list of unital irréductible Jordan module over itself is itself. That means that the free Jordan module, all Jordan modules are free and are tensor product, of course, of the exceptional algebra with some real vector space. Okay? Which is not the case, of course, for the other Jordan module, then even from the list I give, there are a lot of different kinds. Okay. Now, I come back to my original point. My original point was that I consider that the explanation or the formulation, the right formulation of the lepton quark symmetry is the identification of the octonion algebra, one identification, as with C4, C plus C3, C being the component of the unit, the complex component of the unit. So now I want to look at the automorphism of the exceptional algebra. The automorphism of the exceptional algebra is the exceptional group F4. But the subgroup which preserve in this matrix the splitting C plus C3 of the octonion which the three octonion which appear here, okay, is the group SU3 cross SU3 over Z3. Okay? And now to express this action, I write this matrix. I separate, you see, the part of X3, which is in C, component of the unit, in the separation C plus C3, and the component in sort of leptonic component, I would say, and the component in quark. So here I obtain a Hermitian 3x3 complex matrix, okay? And here I obtain a 3x3 complex matrix, a whole 3x3 complex matrix, okay? And now the action here is given by the following thing. the action of UV, say, of SU3 cross SU3 them, is the following. It's the adjoint action of V on the Hermitian part in the complex matrix, and on the part which is a complete complex matrix, not the Hermitian part, it's U times M times V star. So U, with U, you recognize the SU3, which was called the color, the SU3, which act on the quark, on each quark, okay? So it's really this SU3 which is here. But there is another SU3 which occurs on the... So you see that, of course, if I multiply both by an element of the center, by Z3, it disappears, okay? So it's why it's SU3 cross SU3 over Z3, okay? So there is a nice proof of this in the book of Yokota, an exceptional Lie group, okay? But it's not difficult to... Okay. Now, of course, I want to interpret the triality. You see, there is an obvious triality in the exceptional algebra, which is the triality between the three octonions which occur in them. And in fact, there is a permutation which permutes this matrix, which permutes this octonion, and which permutes the corresponding diagonal part, which are elements of F4, which are automorphism of the algebra. Okay, so the point now is that you can interpret this in two different ways. First, you can say that this corresponds to these three octonions of the matrix element of an arbitrary element of my exceptional algebra. Second, you can be more subtle and say, it looks like the same thing, but it is not. This triality corresponds to the three canonical subalgebra of 2x2 matrix, okay, which correspond also to the three corresponding octonions. Okay? So you have two by two matrix, you see, which are the complement of each diagonal projector, the three diagonal projectors. Okay? So, and you will see that this latter thing is better than the first thing. So let me say, if I take the first point of view, of course, I have to add for each generation the two elements of the family, okay? The neutrino part and the electronic part, okay? So this is but when you do that, you see you have some particle which appear here on the diagonal, and this diagonal is real. So since these are spin 1/2 particles, of course it's natural in the Minkowski space to interpret this real thing as some Majorana spinor, which is a good thing, because Majorana spinor are particles equal to their antiparticles, so no charge at all, which means that there is no spoliation of the cancellation of anomaly of the standard model of particles, which is absolutely necessary to have a consistent quantum field theory of this, of gauge theory of this. Okay, so now let me forget a little this and pass to the other interpretation. So why the other interpretation is interesting? It is because the 2x2 Hermitian octonionic matrix already contain one family of the model. To see that, you see, you look at the subgroup again, you see, the 2x2 Hermitian octonionic matrix is the spin factor 9, as I said at the beginning, okay? But if, so it's spin 9, which is the automorphism of this algebra, the automorphic group, but the subgroup of the automorphism which preserves the splitting of the octonion C+C' is exactly SU3 cross SU2 cross U1 over Z6. And this is exactly the group of the standard model for one generation. The standard model was written for one generation, okay? So this shows you that I am on a good shape to say. But furthermore, if I look at the Jordan module, you see this spin factor are strongly special, which means that essentially you can extract the Jordan module from their associative envelope, which are the Clifford algebra. So here I take the star associative envelope, okay, which is defined by this relation, okay. Here is the Jordan product, okay, of this 2x2 Hermitian octonionic matrix, and this is the definition of the associative algebra CL9. And then it's a fact, this is the 16x16 matrix over C plus itself, two times, okay? So now in this 16x16 matrix, you see immediately that you have exactly what is needed to put, I go a little quickly because because this can live in a space of dimension 32, which is exactly what you need to place all particles of one generation of the standard model, the standard. I have not the time to explain, because there, of course, the observable are in the diagonal part of all this, etc. Now, if I want to go further, now I must define the theory of connection on the Jordan module, and first of all, a differential calculus. So what is the analog of differential form on such a Jordan algebra? And I claim that, well, I will take as the analog of differential form a graded over n Jordan superalgebra for the degree n over 2n, for the induced Z2 degree equipped with a differential, okay? So I will call a differential calculus over G a differential graded Jordan algebra such that omega 0, in degree 0, it's the original algebra. It's really the most natural thing. So I have to show that this exists, okay? So this is the derivation base differential calculus, which is, okay. So I have not the time to go really in detail, but the important thing is that my opinion is that, and is that this internal connection, you see, I will have a connection on space-time simultaneous. This internal connection is the X field, okay? Is the X field, which breaks the symmetry. And the reason of that is that you can have several connections of this internal connection such that the curvature vanishes, but which are not equivalent. Now, if you take the action, Euclidean action, the norm of the curvature square, this means that you have several minima. And these minima are interpret a several vacuum. And to start a quantum theory, you have to choose one and to make a development around. And this is exactly the Higgs phenomenon. Okay, so, I am sorry. There is, of course, once you are here, you can define a connection over the Jordan module, the curvature, and even some general connection. But okay, I want nevertheless to show you this thing. If you look at a free Jordan module, okay, then of course the curvature, there is a part of the curvature which is given by the differential of your differential calculus, and the rest, okay, is an homomorphism of Jordan module, okay? So in particular, and the curvature is defined by this relation, okay? So in particular, if you have followed what I have explained on free Jordan module and free Jordan module over their center, for any of our algebra, the center is trivial. So this means that the components of this A are scalar. So they cannot see any derivation. So the first term is zero. So the vacuum are exactly the representation in your external vector space of your free module of the origin. Bon, okay, so this of your, and so you see you have as many vacuum, c'est ce que tu sais, as you have representation of the Lie algebra of derivation there. So of course I will take as Lie algebra of derivation not all the automorphisms, but the one which preserve the lepton quark symmetry, so the splitting of the octonion which occurs there as C plus C3. Okay? This is like the Minkowski metric. It introduces some restriction on the automorphism that you have to look at it. But this one is completely... So you see, everything now is really recovered. You recover all the group of the standard model. You recover the particle, the space where they are. And you can start the theory by mixing the internal connection with the connection over space-time and write a gauge theory there with this group. So I have jumped a little quickly over one thing. Sorry, I would like to...
You're not allowed to go back.
Which is here, okay. You see what happened here when I take this interpretation of generation, okay? This corresponds to the out of GE, which are isomorphic to spin 9, and GE are isomorphic to the group of the standard model for one generation for each of these. But you see that, here, there is the first SU3 is well known. It's a SU3 of color group of the quark from which we start. And the second SU3 project on each generation over the group of the standard group. Okay, but the part, the electromagnetic weak part of this. So with Ivan Todorov, we call in one of the last paper, this part, the electroweak SU3, the general electro generalization of the SU3 for all the model with the three generation. Sorry, so I stop here because unfortunately, yeah.